Everything I just delineated is unfolding, and there's evidence to support it, not solely an inverted treasury yield curve, which is intriguing. Well, Tuesday 10 is the primary sector where it's inverted, but notably more profoundly in the Eurodollar futures curve. Yes, I dubbed the treasury yield curve a brief bet on a long-term rate. The Eurodollar futures curve is a protracted wager on a brief rate, because the Eurodollar future is akin to predicting the overnight rate 2 years from end. Ow! Say, okay, long-term bet on a brief rate, and it's inverted and it shouldn't be inverted. It does occur, but it should not happen. Yield curves should be ascending just because of time, value of money, and uncertainty, etc. If I lend over an extended period or make a further forward bet, I should receive a higher rate. Well, why do people wagering on overnight rates a year or 2 years from now think that rates are going to be lower? And that shouldn't happen. The only rationale for that is we're going to go into a recession. It's going to get a lot worse. But reverting to a genuinely significant differentiation between a recession, even a severe one, and a financial crisis, because they're two distinct things, they can coincide. But for instance, in 1998, we encountered an acute financial crisis, and with long-term capital management, and I negotiated that bailout, that front row seat on that one. But 1994, the tequila crisis, and there was the bond market massacre. There had been these financial crises, but there was no recession in 1998. In fact, the NASDAQ surged long-term capital. We were nursing our injuries after the meltdown and flicking on CNBC and observing pets.com, the sock puppet, and all these things. They're escalating like, hey, we just got wiped out. But the opposite is factual. You can have a downturn without a financial panic. 1990, we had somewhat of a moderate downturn. There was no financial panic then. 2020 was intriguing. I mean, technically a downturn, but the economy drops 31% annualized. And they say 2 quarters, first and second quarter of 2020. But it was genuinely 2 months. I mean, if you dissect it, it was March and April, but they happened to fall in 2 quarters and dragged both quarters negative. But it was genuinely 2 months, down 31% in annualized in 2 months, and then up 35% by the third quarter. I mean, that was astounding. So perhaps that's technically a downturn. That's just what occurs when you shut down the economy. But there was no financial panic. Stock market plummeted, but the banks didn't fail. Nobody's queued up to withdraw funds from Citibank, etc. So you can have downturns without panics. You can have panics without downturns. October 19th, 1987. Dow falls. 2002% one day, no downturn. Occasionally they do coexist. In 2008, they did. We had both. We had honest to goodness financial panic. Everyone knows Bear Stearns, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, Lehman IG. But I can tell you, and I've conversed with numerous people, Morgan Stanley was days away. And then Goldman would have been behind that, probably Citi, and maybe JP Morgan would have been the last one. And the economy collapsed. And the stock market fell well of 50%, I think 60%. So that was an exemplification of both. And what I'm apprehensive about is we may be heading into both, to everything I said about what's behind the curtain, the plumbing of the financial system, acute dollar shortage, scramble for collateral, which leads to deleveraging, because if I can't get the collateral, I have to take the trade-off leveraging of balance sheets, etc., which are the early warning signs of a global financial panic and a probable downturn. We could very well be looking at a severe downturn and a global liquidity crisis. Two different things, but they could converge. Give a little credit to Robert Shiller. He wrote a great book called Narrative Economics. Now, narrative is just a sophisticated term for a story. It's like, okay, you can call it a narrative, and it means a lot of people buy into it, but it just means there's a story that people believe. And this goes back to the greatest sociologist of the 18th century, Robert K. Mert. There's no Nobel Prize in sociology. But if there were, Robert K. Merton would have won it. But he's the one who came up with the phrase, the self-fulfilling prophecy. And the classic case is you wake up in the morning, the bank's fine, but somebody gets nervous, and they run down and take all their money out. And somebody sees them and go, what are you doing? I'm getting my money out of this bank. Okay, I better get my money out too. And everyone's like, I don't want to be the last one out. Next thing you know, there's a line around the block. By the end of the day, the bank shuts its doors, and they're bankrupt. But they weren't bankrupt at 9 in the morning. It's because a story spread. People believed it. People acted on it. That's the key. Do you act on the story? You can make the thing you're worried about come true, even though it wasn't true when the story started. Narratives can be true, but they can be false. In other words, a completely false narrative can be extremely powerful if enough people buy into it. The Fed pivot is a narrative, and it went like this. So inflation takes everyone by surprise in fall. Late 2021, November 2021, JPL says, time to retire. The word transitory, and then inflation goes to the roof. The stock market goes down. It's still going down, but then after the Fed raised rates and then the yield curve is inverted, the narrative is like, well, wait a second. The yield curve inversion is telling us that rates are going to be lower months from now. Inflation is cooling off a little bit, and it has, and so they're going to have to cut rates. That was the pivot. And rate cuts are good for stocks. So buy stocks, then we get this rally. And the stock markets we cover in a lot of this, not all the lost ground, by the way, but a lot of it all based on the Fed pivot narrative, which I never bought into. I mean, you don't want to stand in front of a moving train. I wasn't going to short the SP. I did not buy into the narrative. I said for two reasons. Number one, oh, inflation came down from 9. Well, that's nice. But you say you want to get it to 2. You're a long way from 2. And how much demand destruction? How many rate hikes? How much do you have to do to really destroy the economy to get inflation down to 2? The answer is a lot. And tell me why that's good for stocks. It's not. But the other reason is, and this is a little more sophisticated analytically, but just because the yield curves are telling you that market pros think rates are going to be lower, doesn't mean the Fed's going to cut. That is the message. But it doesn't mean the Fed's going to get the message. How many times does the Fed get things right? The answer is never. The buy the dips crowd have not gone away.